Hello everyone, I'm Bob and this is the Home Bitcoin Immersion Mining channel. In this build series episode, we're going to cover the build of my hydronics loop that will cool my Bitcoin miners and will be used to heat my house. So with that, let's get started. Okay, so in the last episode, I covered the basics of using a hydronic loop to cool your Bitcoin miner as part of a dual loop home Bitcoin immersion mining setup. I talked through the different parts of the loop, including how to design everything so it works together. Now for my home setup, I want to use my miners to help heat my house, my water, and my garage. And so I'm going to build a complete hydronic system to make that happen. But I'm going to walk through this step by step. And so in today's episode, I'm just going to cover the basic part of my hydronics loop and leave the home heating sections to future episodes. Now, as noted in the last episode, my first decision to make is what cooling fluid to use. Looking at my options of either ethylene glycol or propylene glycol to keep my lines from freezing, I chose to use propylene glycol. And I chose this for two reasons. First, I have a dog in my house. Ethylene glycol is very toxic to both people and animals, and unfortunately, it has a very sweet taste. Many animals have been killed by licking up ethylene glycol spills. In fact, most automotive antifreeze containing ethylene glycol now include bittering agents to foul that sweet taste to prevent this from happening. Now, I could have tried to find an ethylene glycol mix which included this type of additive, but it seemed like a hassle, and I just didn't want to take that chance with my dog. My second reason for not picking ethylene glycol is that I'm going to be using my hydronics loop to heat my water. And although I'll be doing everything I can to keep my drinking water separate from the glycol water loop, you never know if there's a small pinhole or other imperfection in the heat exchanger or other component that could cause mixing of fluids. So I just didn't think it was worth the risk to use a toxic fluid here. So I chose a propylene glycol mix called Dow Frost HD made by Dow Chemical. This is made for cooling loops and other heat transfer applications and includes additives to prevent corrosion of system components. I purchased a 5-gallon drum of 100% concentration through a company called ChemPoint, who made the whole buying experience really easily. I highly recommend using them. I then bought 5 gallons of deionized water from my local Culligan water dealer and then mixed these two together in a 50-50 mix. This mixing ratio will lower the freezing temperature of my cooling fluid to about negative 25 degrees Fahrenheit, which should keep my system working through the winter. With my fluid picked out, the next step is the design of my hydronics loop. And here's a complete diagram of my system. Now, it looks a little complicated, but it is not that bad if we take things step by step. Removing all the extra valves and gauges, here's the basic system. And it starts with the heat exchanger between the miner and the hydronics loop. Now, I described my heat exchanger in a past episode, but at that time, I wasn't able to cover the correct way to pipe fluid through a heat exchanger, because at that point, I only had one side of the heat exchanger built. So focusing on the heat exchanger, there's two options for routing the fluid. First, there's parallel flow, where both fluids flow in the same direction through the heat exchanger. Then there's counterflow, where the fluids flow in opposite directions through the heat exchanger. Now, this might seem like a minor detail, but in many cases, this can make a huge difference in heat exchanger effectiveness. When possible, you always want to use a counterflow design where the fluids are flowing in the opposite direction through the heat exchanger. This will maximize how much heat you will transfer between the two flowing loops. Getting back to my system, next up is the air and dirt separator. Now you can buy dirt separators and air separators as separate components, but Calefi makes a combined air and dirt separator unit, which makes for a simpler piping design. The model I chose to use is called Discal Dirt 546. Next up is the circulator pump. Now, in the last episode, I covered how to catalog all of the components in the system, use that information to calculate an overall equivalent length, and then combine that length with fluid flow rate to size the pump using pump curve charts. Now, I'm not going to walk through all that detail here. It's a lot of boring spreadsheets, detailed bookkeeping, and math. But out of all that work, here is the estimate of my system head loss curve overlaid onto the pump curve chart for my chosen pump, which is model UPS 15-58FC made by Grundfos. As you can see, I chose a multi-speed pump, so if I messed up my math, I've got some options to increase the speed of my pump and still make my system work. Next up is the pipe routing between my mining room and the dry cooler radiators outside my house. As I covered in my site survey episode, this covers about 40 feet each way, and that length had to be included in my equivalent length calculations. Also, this is where my loop will connect to my home heating and hot water heating, which I will cover in future episodes. Next up is the air vent. This is located at the highest point in my loop, which is right before piping exits my garage and enters into my dry cooler radiators. I used an air vent found on Amazon. There's a link below if you want to use something similar in your system. And one thing to note here, most of these type of air vents are not really designed to work outside, exposed to all the different types of weather. So if you can, it is best to put your highest point of your system indoors where you can use one of these cheaper air vents. The dry cooler radiators are next, and I covered these in past episodes covering dry coolers, so I'm not going to spend any time on them here. Moving on to the expansion tank, I found a great 2-gallon tank which has integrated mounting brackets, making it easy and cheap to mount this in place, and I've got a link below if you're interested in using something similar in your system. And finally, as part of my makeup system, which I'll talk about in detail in a minute, I used a model autofill 553 valve made by Cleffy for my pressure regulating valve. Now with the basic hydronic loop in place, I added some more components. First, as I noted in my dry cooler build episode, I'm using a mixing valve to control the temperature of the fluid returning from my dry coolers. You can learn more of how that will work in my episode on dry cooler design. To fill my system, I installed two purge and fill valves, one near the dry cooler and one down by the heat exchanger. This will give me some flexibility in how I want to get the cooling fluid in and out of the system. Both of these are model 5861 purge and fill valve made by Webstone. I also added another ball valve on the other side of the dry cooler so I can close off my dry coolers from the rest of the system if needed. On both sides of my pump, I used ball valves that are integrated into the attachment flanges. These are made by Bell & Gossett, model A-117H. These will let me close off the system and swap out the pump. It's highly recommended to spend a little extra money here and add these type of pump isolation valves to any hydronics loop, just in case if your pump needs to be switched. And finally, I added a small gate valve at the lowest point of the system, which will allow me to completely drain all the fluids out of the loop. This isn't essential, but it can be really handy if you need to drain your loop. Next up are gauges. Now I found a really inexpensive analog gauge that measures both temperature and pressure in the same readout. I use these all over my system, and I've got a link below if you're interested in using something similar in your system. I have gauges on either side of the heat exchanger so I can monitor entering and exiting temperatures, and I also have a gauge located at the high point of the system near the air vent. This will enable me to ensure that the system is pressurized correctly. When fully pressurized, the pressure at this gauge should read somewhere between 5 and 10 psi. I also have a gauge located at the exit of my mixing valve. This gauge will enable me to fine-tune the temperature of the fluid exiting the mixing valve to prevent under- or overcooling the return fluid. Now, the last part of my system designed to cover is my makeup system. Now, with a glycol water system like mine, using my city water input as a source for makeup fluid could be a problem over time in that it might dilute the glycol. This would increase the freezing temperature of the fluid, risking my system freezing in the winter. They do make standalone glycol makeup systems that are specialized for this type of application, but they can be very costly, and it's really overkill for a system like this. So instead, I designed a DIY makeup system using an extra expansion tank. The way this works is during system filling, I let out some of the air in the pressurized portion of the tank, allowing the tank to partially fill with glycol water solution. Then I repressurize the tank to 40 to 50 psi, and this creates a high pressure source behind the pressure regulating valve. As small amounts of air leaves the system, fluid will leave this tank and fill the loop, maintaining system pressurization. Now, there is a downside with this approach. There's only a limited amount of fluid available to refill the system. And because of that, I need to make sure there are no leaks anywhere in the system, or I'll run out of backfill fluid and lose system pressurization. One more topic to cover before taking a look at what I built is the pressure relief valve. Normally, a pressure relief valve is an essential safety component for a hydronic loop. But in my system, I didn't include one. My thinking here is my hydronics loop is completely isolated from my household water supply, so there's no way I can affect the normal operation of my home. Also, there's a limit to how hot my hydronics loop can get. The miners supplying heat to the system will automatically shut down if they get too hot. So there's really no way for my hydronics loop to get into a runaway heating condition, creating an overpressurization event. So my thinking here is a pressure relief valve really isn't needed, so I didn't include one in my system. And so with my design covered, let's go see how this turned out. Okay, so here's the bottom part of my hydronics loop. In a past episode, I showed an image of the top of my loop, so I'm really gonna focus on this part of the loop here. As you can see in my build, I use 1-inch piping for my hydronics loop. This kind of goes against what I said in the last episode, where for a 2-miner system like mine, it's best to use maybe 1/2-inch to 5/8-inch piping. That would keep the fluid flow fast enough to clear out air, but slow enough not to make noise or do damage to your piping system. And the reason why I used 1-inch piping in my design is when I did the calculations to figure out the flow rate and pump size, I found that for narrow piping, I would need a very large pump to drive the fluid throughout my entire cooling loop. It's just that large. A larger pump will require a lot more power to keep the system running on a day-by-day basis. So the trade-off here is I've gone with a larger pipe size, which is gonna keep my electricity costs low, but it'll make the fluid go through my system much slower, which could create problems when I first start my system up and try to clear the air out of the system. Now, after getting everything connected, the next step is to put the fluid in the system and get it up and running. Now, there's a fantastic video out there by Kleffi, which walks through you all the steps you need to take in starting up a hydronic system. I have a link below. I strongly recommend listening to it. You'll learn a lot about what you need to do to make this happen. And the first step to getting everything up and running was to leak check my system. I hooked up my air compressor and pressured up to about 1.5 times the working pressure of the system, which was a little over 20 PSI. And then I went around my entire system with a 50-50 mix of water and dishwashing soap in a spray bottle and sprayed everything down and looked for bubbles. And when I did this, I found quite a few leaks. I'm not a plumber. I'm still learning the art of soldering, and 1-inch pipe is actually kind of hard to solder. And so I'm really glad I did this. I found lots of leaks, was able to fix them before I put fluid into the system. This prevented a lot of messes that I had to clean up down the road. After leak checking your system, the next step is to purge your system of dirt and debris. The Kleffi video goes over how this is done, and there's local contractors you can find who will do this for you if you don't have the equipment yourself. Now, for my system, I didn't purge it. My system's not that big. It looked like a big hassle to kind of take this step. I do have a dirt and air separator right before my pump to catch any debris so it doesn't damage my pump. So I didn't do this. It's a bit of a risk, but it's a corner I decided to cut. In any case, the next thing to do is pressurize your expansion tank and set up your pressure reducing valve for your system. Now, when you buy your expansion tank, most often it is going to be pre-pressurized, but that still means you're going to have to check that pressure to make sure it's right for your system. And figuring out your needed pressure really isn't that hard. The way this works is you measure the height from your top of your tank to the highest point in your system, divide that length by 2, and add 5. That's the number you're looking for your expansion tank. For my case, it's around 15 PSI. Now, this method of calculation is kind of simple. It is going to overpressurize your system a little, but when it comes to hydronic loops, it's better to be overpressurized than underpressurized. To adjust the pressure in my expansion tank, I simply used an automotive pressure gauge at the back of the tank. I had to let a little air out to get down to 15 PSI. It was pretty easy to get straight. And with that set, the next step is to set your pressure regulator valve. For that pressure, you're going to want it at or slightly less the same pressure of your tank. With everything set, the next step is to fill my system. I went around and made sure all the air vents are opened, and then I took a bucket and mixed my Dow Frost and my deionized water, and then I used a drill pump to pump this fluid into my system at my fill and purge valve at the top of my system. Here's a picture showing what that looks like. And I had to do this in several stages. I'd fill my bucket, pump fluid into the system, then refill my bucket, and so on. After the system was mostly full, I turned on my circulator pump to help push the fluid through the lines and get the air out. Using a drill pump in this way is really easy, and a drill pump is a great thing to have around your system when you're working on it. I have a link below if you're interested in getting a similar thing for your system. And with all the air out of my system, the next step was to pressurize my loop. For my system, this was fairly simple. I'm going to step behind the camera and kind of show you exactly how I got that done. First, I turn off the circulator pump and close off the regulator valve. Next, I make sure this isolation valve is open, which means my makeup tank is now feeling the full weight and pressure of all the fluid going up into my garage. I then let out all the air in the back of this tank. The fluid will force its way into the tank, deforming the rubber diaphragm, filling the tank, and storing up my makeup fluid volume. Now, after this step, I went up and topped off the fluid in my system just to make sure it was fully filled. Next, I closed off this isolation valve and then pressurized the remaining air in the back of the tank to about 40 psi using my air compressor. I now have a high-pressure fluid reservoir to keep my system fully pressurized. I double-check that my pressure regulator is at the right pressure, which is about 15 psi in my case, and then I open the regulator valve. This valve lets through just enough high-pressure fluid into the lines to pressurize the whole system to 15 psi. I've went up and checked the pressure gauges at the top parts of my system, and they all read about 5 to 10 psi as expected. So with everything sealed, filled, and pressurized, the next step is to turn my pump on. Now I have my pump directly wired into my load center and to a circuit breaker, so I just have to flip that breaker to turn my pump on. And as you can hear, the pump is almost silent. You almost can't hear it. And this is one of the goals of building an immersion mining system. You want to build something that is so quiet you don't even notice is running. Now, the last thing to cover are some lessons learned. As I talked about before, I went with 1-inch piping in my system. That was to reduce the size of my pump and reduce the amount of electricity needed over the long term to run the hydronics loop. And I think that was a mistake. I think if I had to do this again, I would have used 3/4-inch piping. That would have made the system much cheaper to build and much easier to build. Soldering 1-inch pipe is just more difficult. I had a lot of leaks that I had to fix over the entire system. So again, if I had to do this again, I'd go with 3/4-inch piping and maybe go with a slightly bigger pump. Okay, so that's all I have for today. My hydronics loop is up and running, and that's the last part of my system needed to start mining Bitcoin. I'm super excited about the next few episodes where I'll finally be able to dunk my miners and see the whole system up and running. So with that, bye.